Welcome, dear learners. Welcome in the new module in our course Pedagogical Innovations and Research Methodology. Today, myself, Dr. Ajay Semelti, HNB Garhwal University, a central university, Srinagar Garhwal, Uttarakhand, welcome you on behalf of our entire course team. Today, we'll be dealing with a very crucial topic, that is quality and innovative thesis writing. Dear professors, dear faculty members, in our entire academic career, we do PhDs, we supervise PhDs, we supervise PG dissertations, we write the project reports. For all these, we need to be well versed with the quality thesis writing or report writing elements, the quality and innovative elements we must be well versed with. In this module, we will be dealing with those components which are desired for an effective thesis writing or report writing. Let us open up our discussion with the learning outcome. After going through this module, you will be able to write an effective synopsis, to plan an effective outline, and to write a quality introduction and literature review. Now, first of all, let us discuss about synopsis. What is synopsis? Synopsis is a brief research proposal of your entire work. Basically, it's a concept note of your entire project proposal. You put all the things in brief and put this proposal before the authority which is going to approve your research proposal. These authorities may be research degree committees, or the name may be different in certain institutes. What you have to plan for that? You will have to plan each of your element of research. That planning, a foolproof planning you can say, must be presented in the concise form. The length of synopsis may vary depending upon the requirement subject, depending on the institutional guidelines. So, overall, it should be in that framework, but in the concise way. What are the things you have to remember? Now, let us focus, first of all, the very first topic, the title. The title should be catchy, should not be too lengthy, broadly cover the topic, should easily create the interest, clear, precise, and justify the time limits. I would like to add one thing in title, that your title neither should be too specific nor it should be too broad, because with the passage of time the things may little bit get changed. So every time, even if some change is there in your plan and your overall thesis at the end of completion, your title should be representative. So ask your student, if you are supervising, that keep the title optimum, neither too specific nor too broad. Now moving to the introduction. In the introduction, you give a little background, under quote, little background. You cannot be very broad when you are writing the synopsis. Actually, what you are doing here, that you are answering what? What you are going to do? What is the background? What is the strength there in the topic? What are the deficiencies? What are the research gaps there? You are pinpointing the research gaps in this introduction part and putting the layout of your research. Remember that in introduction, you must not give a huge background. A background should be optimum one when you are giving the historical background of that particular topic. And this introduction may differ from streams, from sciences to humanities and social sciences. In sciences, you may justify addition of figure or graph for better explanations, where in case of arts and humanity, You may need some already reported data to prove relevance of the topic. And by the end of introduction, in both the cases, you should state how your area of research is different from others. Now let us focus on the things to remember. Introduction should be started with reflecting the background, justifying the need of research. Put the statement of problem, how your research is different from existing one, and references should be cited. The introduction should not have a strict word limit, unlike the abstract, okay? But it should be as concise as possible. As we have already mentioned, sometimes scientists and researchers prefer to write it at last to make sure they haven't missed anything important. Now let us focus the things which you should never do. Should not write about yourself and your supervisor. Don't expose the whole idea and about your expertise. Don't forget to relate your work with basic literature. Now moving to the literature review. Literature review can be defined in many ways. Let us take this first definition: systematic and organized compilation and critical study of related body of knowledge is literature review or literature survey. A literature review surveys books, scholarly articles, and any other sources relevant to a particular issue, area of research, or theory, and by so doing provides a description, summary, and critical evaluation of these works in relation to the research problem being investigated. Now let us look upon the criteria for selecting literature. For synopsis, it should be restricted to 10 to 20 research papers which are important one only, okay. References should be latest. Research papers should be preferred over review papers and should be 100% relevant to the topic. For synopsis, there can be two ways of writing literature review: paragraph wise, like description of paper, running discussion of all the selected papers. Now we move to the aims and objectives. Aim of the study should be in the form of a statement which somewhere reflects the hope, what you want to do, and where you want to finish. Aim is about what you want to do, and objective is about how you are going to do that. Aim should be brief and concise. Realistic means whether you can achieve them in the given time period or not. How you can start for sciences? Let us see. You can start this for sciences with to develop, to design, to prepare, to evaluate, to synthesize, and so on. For other disciplines, to track, to generate, to build, to compare, to critically analyze. In this way, you can start the aims. Now we move to the objectives. You have a statement of aim. Now objective are coming after the aim. Your objective should be SMART. SMART stands for S-M-A-R-T. S for specific, M for measurable, A for attainable, R for relevant, and T for time bound. Each of this is very important in objectives. What you will do? You will frame the objectives, that how you are going to meet the aim, and it should be in good tune with the each aim. You will visualize the sequence of steps through which you are going to achieve your aim with the help of these objectives. So defining objectives is very important, because all the things will depend on the defining of objectives. Objectives should start like that. You will collect, construct, produce, test, trial, measure, and document, pilot, deconstruct, reconstruct, analyze, and in case of sciences, it should go like preparation, formulation, evaluation, statistical application, and comparison. Remember that objective should not be too vague or too ambitious. It should not be repetitive, not lengthy, and not messy. Let us take the methodology. Methodology involves the process of carrying out the actual research. In case of sciences, state the method which you are going to use to prepare, synthesize, and to analyze and mention how did you perform it and describe the materials and equipment used in the research. For humanities, you should state which method you are going to use to collect data, information, cases, etc. and explain if any randomization techniques, statistical methodology you are going to apply. Methodology can usually be divided into a few sections depending upon the area of research. Methodology should be clear, concise, conclusive. Now, what are the things to be kept in mind? If you are mentioning one single method, you have to be specific in description. If you are mentioning multiple strategies, because you didn't yet decide, you haven't decided so far the actual method, or you want to compare different methods, let it be little messy, okay, so that you have enough space to confine the final strategy. Don't discuss the established technique, rather discuss how did you apply it in your research, for example, or how you are going to apply it, okay. Don't discuss single blind and double blind method for off sampling. Everyone knows it. Discuss how you applied in your case or how you are going to apply it in your case. Now, moving to the time schedule of the work. Time schedule is just the timetable of your entire research work. You will present a timetable of your work depending upon your objectives, that this objective will be reached at this particular time period and this objective will be reached at this particular time period, so that the progress can be tracked on the basis of that thing. And for that, you will use critical path method or performance evaluation review technique, PERT, or use the time bar graphs for presenting these things. And remember, neither be too optimistic nor be too pessimistic when you are giving the timetable. So, in the timetable, or you can say in the time schedule, you will put all the components of your research, starting from literature review, procurements, then methods, then completion of the methods, analysis part, and will give a tight time schedule. It should be, as we have discussed, that it should neither be too optimistic nor be pessimistic. It should be rational, so that anyone can track it, anyone can track the progress of your work, especially the research degree committee, because you have to report it time to time that what kind of progress, what progress you have made, and that that will be the benchmark of your real-time progress which you have given in the synopsis. Now, moving to the references. A synopsis should have limited references depending upon the prescribed guidelines. In general, a synopsis should have about 10 to 15 latest references. References should be properly and uniformly cited in the text. The way of reference writing, the style should be uniform, as there are number of reference writing styles. All references should be relevant to the topic. There should be latest one, research articles, authentic one should be reputed, should be from reputed journals and books. So, dear learners, just focus what we have given in the text, that what are the tips for synopsis. Focus that synopsis is a very concise plan which is going to guide your entire research work. And as a faculty member, as a supervisor, you must give your time and efforts in planning the synopsis to your supervisor, to your research scholars, you can say. And if you are a student, obviously you have to be in good tune with the supervisor. Now, moving to the thesis writing. Now, you have given the synopsis, it has been approved, you have got registered, then you did your work. Now, it is the time of writing the thesis. Now, we will write the thesis, but for before that, we will plan a tight outline, a outline of your entire thesis, that what will be the chapter plan, how you are going to move, what will be your strategy. So, plan a tight outline, plan chapters well in advance, and do the work during your research work even. Many times, research scholars start writing the thesis at the end of their 3 years or 5 years time period. It is not the way. Introduction and literature review like chapters should be ready well in advance, because you have already done the things. Literature review have completed. So let us focus firstly to the introduction part. As we have discussed, introduction deals with what and why. What stands for? What you are going to do? What is your hypothesis? A brief you have mentioned there in synopsis. Now it is the time to put it in your thesis. Give the background. The optimum background must be there. And focus that what are the research gaps there in the existing research, and put it systematically, point it out, and then give the solution that, yeah, that's why we are going to do this work, because there was a research gap there and we are going to bridge that gap. So this is the way you write the introduction. Sometimes scientists and researchers prefer to write it at last to make sure they haven't missed anything important. And writing introduction in sciences and life sciences is significantly different from other disciplines. For example, sciences, you can easily justify addition of a figure or graph for better explanation. If the topic is related to the formulation which is used for hair growth, you can discuss anatomy of hair to understand it more clearly. While in case of arts and humanities, you may need some data to prove relevance of the topic. You can also relate it to any established theories. For example, if you are analyzing juvenile delinquency, then we can relate it to the conflict perspective or anomy by Robert Merton, a well-known sociologist. So there is a little difference in that, but in both the cases, by the end of introduction, you should state how your area of research is different from others and connecting it to the research problem you have pointed out and the relevance of the subject. Now let us see what are the things which you should keep in mind in writing introduction. Always start with eye-catching opening sentence that will keep the reader attentive and focused. Keep it broad but not too broad. Provide only helpful, relevant information, relevant background, but don't write anything that reflects argument. Not to say everything you have to say in the introduction, save some of your good material for later. Now, next point is cohesion and coherence. Now, these are very important aspects. Cohesion is a grammatical aspect and coherence is an idea level concept. Your sentences should be linked in a cohesive manner. They should be bind together. That sequencing must be good. And coherence, that each of your sentence should be directly linked to your idea, and the flow of information should be in good tune with the idea processing, because you are processing the information. So unless the cohesion and coherence is there, your reader will find it very difficult to connect or to get the complete idea in an effective manner. So don't forget cohesion and coherence. Now let us move to the literature review. Let me summarize first how we do the literature review. You have done the literature review, okay? Your student has done. What you have done? You have planned the subject area, sources and depth. Then search and compile is the second step. Organize and focus. You have organized all the literature and focused to your theme, your focal point. Then again analysis, and at the last you have identified rationality, novelty and pinpointed your aim and objectives. But this is the way the literature review goes. There are different methods of literature review and it differs from subject or discipline wise. Here I will focus on how to write literature review. You may find several books and write-ups on how to write the literature review, but it's difficult to conclude anything from such waste textbooks, I think I must say that, because it is the subject, it is the topic, and it is the supervisor who will guide the things in their own way. This we also discussed in brief on how to write literature for synopsis. For thesis, we must cover it in more and more depth, and you should do proper referencing of this part along with writing. There are two different ways of writing literature review. Dear friends, we have two different strategies, paragraph wise and running section wise. In paragraph wise, you put one study in one stanza and so on. You do the thing in the synopsis most of the time in this way. But in thesis, it doesn't look nice. It looks scattered. It looks unconnected. A literature review also has the three parts: introduction, body and conclusion. Introduction, you give the background. In body, you modify the idea or you progress that idea. And in conclusion, you give your conclusion and what you are going to do, your assumption or your hypothesis or the problem definition you put there. Now moving to the running section wise. Running section wise is actually the quality way of writing the literature review. When you put all the thoughts in such a way and progress it in running section, you just write it in like a review paper. If you have written a review paper already, a good review paper, analytical review paper, you just put it there. You just take it, that particular review paper, into this section without any change. Don't worry. This will look better than putting the things paragraph wise. So remember these things, because the analytical progression of your idea must be there in this literature review part. Here you may use figure or table judiciously. You can also use flow diagram, pictorial presentations using smart art or paint for better understanding. Cite references properly. Updated or latest references and quality review papers should be written here. Patent survey should be done if relevant or applicable. So dear friends, let me summarize this module for you. What we learned? Thesis and report writing are the most challenging academic task in our academic career. Either you are doing PhD or you are supervising the PhD. It is utmost important to learn the basic aspects. Synopsis. Basically, it's a concept note of your entire research proposal. Plan it effectively, each and every domain, in a brief and concise and effective manner. Introduction, part of your thesis, and other parts, you must plan it. You must plan the outline first and then move of writing thesis. Introduction answers what and why of your research. What is the background of the entire work and why you are doing it? Plan it in cohesive and coherent manner. As far as the literature review is concerned, it is the foundation of your research work. Put your literature review in a systematic manner, in a cohesive and coherent manner. Plan the things sequentially, logically, and put your research problem at the end of the literature review. In the literature review, what you do? You summarize and synthesize your idea. You identify the research gap. What is your solution? What is your hypothesis? You identify or put your idea and identify your aim and objectives. So this is the holistic view of introduction and literature review part of your thesis work. We will deal with the next sections in our next module. So happy learning, and don't forget to refer the further reading links we have given in the text. See you in the next module.